Thank you very much, and thank you to the organizers for inviting me to make this presentation today and come to this beautiful country and city. My title is The Role of Low-Calorie Sweeteners in Diabetes. These are my slides. I did not mix them up, I think, but I wish I could revise them during your presentations because there will be some overlap, I think. But let's see how it goes. I work in the obesity research unit, so normally I focus mainly on obesity and risk factors for different diseases. But today it's mainly on diabetes. These are my conflicts of interests, as far as I remember. So you can have a look at those. Going back to the sweeteners, there has been an increase in the import and production of foods and food products with sweeteners over the past 20 years. Since 1961 and until 2013, this slide shows data from the World Bank from last year. And we can see it's data from Denmark, Australia, and Canada. I'm very happy to have Canada also here because, as you might see, the yellow line, it increases very rapidly after 1991. And with this overrepresentation of Canadians here, you are very, very welcome to explain, maybe not now, but later, what happens in this area of time. Something interesting is happening. Otherwise, there's a slight increase also in the other countries at this point. In the US, this is another axis, so it's million tons. The other was kilotons on the y-axis. There's a gradual increase. So this is something that is being consumed more and more and more. And we already heard a little bit about the biochemical structure. And there's also differences in not only this, but also sweetness, ADI levels, and so on. And it's very important that we remember this, as pointed out very clearly by Alison, that the structure and the biochemistry is very different, so therefore also the ingestion or digestion and secretion is very different, and therefore also most likely the biological effects of these sweeteners, if any, because you must remember that they are very intense in sweetness and the amount that we use is extremely low compared with sucrose. It's 1/200 parts or 1/13,000 parts of sucrose. So it's very, very little. So how big an impact can such a little amount have, really? That's a question. We also looked, or Alison looked at this, so I will just skip it, just reminding you that this is, these are different sweeteners with different metabolic fate. As I said, I work with obesity most of the time, and of course the risk factors. So I just had to show this very nice meta-analysis already presented by John. But it was a great piece of work by Peter Rogers, I agree with that. And the favor is towards the low-caloric or non-caloric sweeteners compared with sucrose. In adults, and there's also a very nice Dutch study, De Reuter, in children, showing this quite convincingly. When I was invited for this talk, I thought that I must do something to get a grip on the literature, and I have some very good students who help with that. And this is not a meta-analysis. I don't know if this is good or bad at this point in time, but I did not do a meta-analysis. Maybe you had enough of those. This is a literature study of the prospective observational studies and the randomized controlled trials. And this is just a small table about the main findings, type 2 diabetes incidence and metabolic syndrome. And you can see there's a positive association, as we heard, with the risk of type 2 diabetes and intake of non-caloric sweeteners. If you adjust for BMI or body weight, most of this disappears, and also if you adjust for energy intake. So it's most likely related to this effect on BMI or reverse causality, as we heard. So the ones who choose these drinks or foods may be the ones who have the most need for them because they want to control their weight and their diabetes. So this nice evidence hierarchy, also presented by John, was The cohort study is now to the randomized controlled trials. I'm glad it was in another color, so maybe it's... So we have the clinical intervention studies in a similar table, and here you see red signs, and that means no association, no difference between non-caloric sweeteners and the control situation. In the bottom, you see that there is some association, but in this case, it's, or some differences. In this case, it's in favor of the sweeteners, so a lower level of fasting insulin or postprandial glucose and insulin. I'll just dwell two slides on the MASC study, also presented partly previously. This was a very nice study conducted in 60 subjects in total, 6 months randomized controlled trial with these four drinks, 1 liter per day. And the caloric amount was the same with the skimmed milk and the Coca-Cola, which is important when you look at some of the data they found in the study. And the aspartame sweetened diet cola and the water control. There was a lot of measurements, some of which you saw already, but I will show you something you didn't see already. I'm very happy about that. And this is the OGTT after they did it before and after the 6 months. So it was published earlier this year by a PhD student of ours. And there are absolutely no differences in the insulin sensitivity measured by this method after 6 months. There was another very nice study published recently from the group of Richard Mattis. They intervened with aspartame, two different doses or nothing, in a drink for 12 weeks. They powered the study to look at glycemia, so there were about 90 subjects in the study. And what they saw with an OGTT after 12 weeks was that there were no differences at all between the three groups. Healthy, lean adults. This is also, of course, important to remember. What are the subjects? Were they overweight? Were they at risk? Prediabetes, etc. But here they were healthy, lean adults. Going back to the study in the table with the green marks, which is one of our own studies, we also looked at postprandial glucose and insulin and other things after 10 weeks intervention with non-caloric sweetened foods and beverages or sugar sweetened food and beverages. So the products were similar except for the content of sweetener or sugar. And the rest of the diet was ad libitum, so they could choose what they normally ate, but of course in less amount because we gave them supplements with these foods and drinks. It was yogurt, it was desserts, it was marmalade, and it was soft drinks and syrups. And about two-thirds were drinks and one-third were solid foods. So more maybe a real-life situation, you could say, than giving them aspartame as a pill or like that. We did see significant differences. The plasma glucose and insulin and triglycerides were significantly lower with the sweeteners after 10 weeks, both after lunch and breakfast and lunch. When we adjusted for differences in body weight, because they lost weight on the sweetener condition and gained weight on the sucrose condition, with 2.5 kilograms difference after 10 weeks, and that was significant. When we adjusted for that and adjusted for differences in energy intake, etc., we still saw some significant differences in these parameters. Specifically, insulin state significantly different. And I should remember to say the triglyceride difference disappeared after adjusting for fasting value in this study as well. We also look at GIP and GLP-1, which are gastrointestinal hormones important for glucose regulation, insulin regulation. And they have been also claimed to increase mysteriously after intake of non-caloric sweeteners. And we did see some increase, but you must remember that we also gave real foods and drinks with other components such as carbohydrate, fat, and protein. But there were still significant differences with a lower level after the sweetener than after the sucrose condition, even after adjusting for all these things that we could adjust for. Recently, there was another nice meta-analysis of 29 studies by Nichols et al. Just published. And they made another way of showing these, not the normal tree plot or whatever you call it that we see, but they tried to make a trajectory of the expected blood glucose level after consuming non-caloric sweeteners. And here it's compared with baseline. We don't see the control situation, which could be different ones, but at least they compared it with baseline here, and there was a gradual decrease in blood glucose from 0 minutes to about 3 hours in the end, with about 0.3 millimole per liter decrease. So no increase after non-caloric sweeteners. We have seen a little bit about this earlier, so I will not dwell so much with it, but in EFSA already in 2011 said that it would be useful to use non-caloric sweeteners instead of sugar to lower postprandial blood sugar. And now the ADA and also Diabetes UK and others have stated that sweeteners may be helpful to reduce overall caloric and carbohydrate intake, and they are generally safe and may be recommended. But there are still some uncertainties, and there are still some beliefs, or we shouldn't believe, we should know, but it's when you don't know that much, you believe, and therefore we need to know more. And the study by Azad, very nicely presented also, does raise a lot of questions. I agree with John there. So we were already in 2015-16, there was a call from the EU, the European Commission, about sweeteners. And we joined forces with a lot of good people, and Jason Halford from Unilever, and Joe Harold, of course. And finally, we made an application in February last year, and another application in September last year. It's a long process. And then finally, we were the lucky ones to get the grant. And now we are also the ones to have to do the work. So we started 1st of October this year, officially, and then we go for 5 years. We will look at all these things listed here. And we are 29 partners, as far as I know. We almost hit the border, the limit of 30. We have organized the project like this. You can't see a lot, but there are different boxes with scientific and industry advisory board headed by Ian McDonald. We have the project management unit, innovation advisory panel, steering committee, and the coordinators, etc. And then we have the different work packages focusing on the production, innovation and production, work package one, short-term trials, work package two, the long-term trials, work package three, epidemiological data, work package four, and then sustainability. We will also look at that, because is it in fact more or less sustainable to use sugar than sweeteners or vice versa? I don't think at this point many people know anything about that. So that's going to be really interesting, I think. And innovation and exploitation is work package six. And then we also have cross-cutting themes, we call them, on consumer perspective and on safety. I'll just mention a little bit about work package three, where I'm the lucky one to be the leader, together with the other partners in this work package. We will look at the efficacy and safety of combined and prolonged use of sweeteners and sweetness enhancers as part of a healthy diet. This is very important. It has to be as part of a healthy diet. This was also in the call, and we need to live up to that. So it's not just giving a pill or something else. It has to be incorporated as part of a healthy diet. And we will look at obese and overweight adults and children. The co-primary endpoints are efficacy, so the change in body weight, and safety, change in microbiota, which you may be happy to hear about. It's very hot. And we also have a lot of secondary endpoints, of course. So we try to cover everything. I will welcome good ideas and suggestions, anything that we could still incorporate in our trial, because it will start probably 1 year after the official start date with the recruitment. So any good ideas or suggestions could still be perhaps incorporated. This is a long-term clinical trial. It's for 1 year intervention and then 1 year follow-up, so 2 years in total. And for the adults, we start with a weight loss phase with a low-calorie diet. So we're actually going to look at weight loss maintenance rather than just what happens. So it will be after, and this has been done in the Peters and in your study, but not exactly like this. And we also have the children, but they don't do the LCD. And there should come something, if I can manage. We will recruit 660 participants in total, adults and children, so about 165 per center. We have four clinical trial centers, including Copenhagen, Harakopio, and they are the co-leads with Yannis Manios. And then we have Ellen Blark in Maastricht, and Tanya Adams, and the University of Navarra with Alfredo Martinez and Santiago. And we hypothesized, this is in the call and in our proposal, so we cannot really change that now if you think differently, but we hypothesized that the combined and prolonged use of SNSEs in beverages and food matrices will increase palatability of the diet and thereby increase compliance to the recommendations for a healthy diet, so it will be easier to follow the recommendations to eat less sugar, eat less calories, perhaps in general, etc. And this will result in improved body weight control and thereby provide an efficient tool for combating obesity and obesity-related risk factors in the long term. We also hypothesize that there will be no safety concerns using SNSEs in the long term. Thank you for your attention.